Hey guys, this video is a little different than I normally do. It's a recorded Zoom conversation with someone who was trying to buy a hostel, is trying to buy a hostel. And I get these calls all the time. I do Zoom calls with people all the time who are trying to realize their dreams of starting a hostel. But I found that this Zoom call was a little different. So I wasn't sure if I was going to publish it in the beginning, but later I found that there was enough information here that would be of interest to people who are running hostels, people who are buying hostels, and people who are just starting a hostel from scratch. So unfortunately, though, the audio isn't great, but hopefully you'll be able to get some good information out of it anyway. All right, on to the video. Hey everyone, Darren from hostelmanagement.com. I wanted to make a video with Daniel Minini. He's doing something that's very unique. In the 30 years that I've run hostels, I've encountered a lot of people who say they want to start a hostel. And I can now pretty quickly tell who's going to be successful in that and who's not. It seems like a lot of people will come to me and say, Darren, if you get me a hostel, then I'll do the work. And Daniel's one of those exceptions where he's already doing the work in advance of actually obtaining the hostel. And he realizes, I think, probably from his experience, which we'll get into, that the work starts at the startup phase, not once everything is all magically appeared. And even when you're buying an existing hostel. So welcome, Daniel. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Thanks for having the time.
So tell us a little bit about yourself and what you're doing and why you decided to start a hostel.
Yeah, sure. So my background is that I started my first company with the age of 11 years old. So I started some internet projects and invested my pocket money into new projects. I paid other people who went to school with me to code new projects. I'm now 33 years old and I've started about 50 different internet projects and have founded several successful companies, and now I search some new project that is outside of the digital area. I want to start something that is taking place in real life, where I meet my customer in real life. Mm-hmm. And I love to travel around, so I have the possibility to work from all over the world. Right now I'm in Sicilia, and next month I'm going to Costa Rica. When I travel around, I always stay in hostels because that's the easiest way to get in contact with new people and to get in contact to different cultures. And that's why I love hostels. And my passion is to bring people together and give the community something back. I want to build the infrastructure for people to meet and to have a good time. And I think a hostel is the perfect way to achieve this. For sure, you can also build up a bar or a club that has also the social atmosphere. But hostel is the base to have a very deep connection to the people because you're living together. Now I'm trying to get into the business and to learn everything about real estate and hospitality management and things like this. And so that's how I met you, because you are the expert in this area for hostel owners, and I'm happy to talk with you.
No, thanks. I think that actually nowadays, your experience with online startups is actually going to be very helpful when you start to run a hostel. And I think a lot of hostel owners know this, the ones that are successful, because it's all online marketing now. And also, just in terms of creating the community in the hostels, there are some ways in which, at least for myself, who've had a hostel for 30 years, where the internet has disrupted that personal community that happens in hostels. One, people are not forced to interact with the community anymore because they can still stay in touch with their friends and family all over the world. Mm-hmm. Number two is because they can get infinite amounts of information about their destination. And in fact, are often required to schedule and make reservations for all of the activities they want to do. Oftentimes they get to the hostel and they already have their itinerary planned. And so there's less reliance on word of mouth and connecting with other people in the hostel. So hostels have really had to work harder to create that community. And one of the things that we do in San Francisco is trying to solidify that community of travelers even before they arrive. So as soon as they make a reservation, we put them into an online community that will then manifest itself into a real life community when they're there. So they can start communicating with guests that are going to be in the hostel when they stay and make plans together. So for many hostels, the technology part of running a hostel that has emerged has been very challenging. So I think you're going to have a very interesting insights and expertise in running your hostel, both from digital marketing and also creating that community. And what I didn't mention at the beginning is I said, Daniel's done something very unique. He actually created a website, bought the domain buyhostel.com in order to make his pitch to hostel owners that may be interested in selling. A lot of times people will come to me and say, hey, find me a hostel, but you are realizing that it requires a lot of door knocking. A lot of owners don't really know that they want to sell until you actually approach them with a great deal.
Yeah. So you're completely right. So the first thing you said, creating a community with the hostel guests is very important. I totally agree with you. I've visited, meanwhile, 50 different hostels for personal reasons, for vacation, and to meet other people. And what I've noticed, you are not required to have kind of technological background to offer this community. Easiest part that you can do it to create a WhatsApp group and to publish the QR code on the check-in and the reception and ask your staff to like just push the guest to join the WhatsApp group and to publish daily activities to this WhatsApp group. So that's the easiest thing that you can do, but I've noticed that a lot of hostels are not doing this. And there's always a correlation between a WhatsApp group is available or is not available that correlates with how the social interactivity between the guests arriving late to the hostel and most of the people are already going to a restaurant or going to a bar. And late arrivals can just follow up by just texting into the WhatsApp group, hey, where are you right now? And they send the place and you can join.
So you've actually already seen hostels that have used a WhatsApp group and hostels that have not. And you've seen the difference in the community. And it's interesting.
Yeah.
Because back 33 years ago, when I was backpacking in Europe, I was studying what makes a good hostel, what the architecture that makes community coalesce. And I see that you're doing the same thing in your hostel stays. This is all research for your hostel as well. We use the same thing. My hostel in San Francisco, we used a WhatsApp group. And as soon as somebody makes a reservation, they receive an invitation to join that group. And then also somebody from the staff would reach out to them. We called it a buddy email, where it was just a personal email, where it was like, hey, I'm here at the hostel. Just saw your reservation come through. I wanted to invite you in advance into our community. This is the WhatsApp group. And it's so important now because otherwise you're just selling a cheap place to stay.
True.
That's not what hostels are.
It's so easy to do. So you can also automate this email, like using placeholders and that you're not writing every time the same text. So it's so easy to do, to send a welcome email before the guest is arriving that is including tips about the transportation, tips about sightseeing and other things to make the guests to feel more welcome.
Yep, exactly. And in fact, when you were talking about the emails, many property management systems allow you to customize your outgoing email, your reservation confirmation email, and you can usually add in tokens for the name and reservation details. I know the PMS system that Hostel Management produces, Hostel Snap, you can customize all of those emails as much as you want. So you could even include a QR code so that they can their phone scan it on their screen, however they want to get into that WhatsApp group. But I think you're really smart. Tell me about what type of property you're looking for. I know it's on your website, but tell everyone else.
Yeah, sure. So what I've noticed is that it's important to have at least a minimum amount of beds in your hostel so that you have group big enough to interact. So what I'm searching is a property that can cover a minimum of 30 beds. It's important to have a bar or to have at least a permit to build up a bar. So I've already discovered that there are two different permits. Like the first permit is only for inside guests and second permit is also for outside guests. So it should have at least a permit for inside guests. So you can have one meeting point. It's always a bar. So we know that alcohol is dangerous, but it's the most common social activity of everybody on the world is to drink a beer. Most people meet first at the bar, or when you're alone, where you're going, you're not sitting down to the kitchen table and waiting that something's happening. You go to the bar, get a beer, and the next person is coming to the bar and get a beer. That's the first person you maybe talk to beside of the staff members. And there, the social connection developed. It has to have a bar permit. I'm searching a hostel that is placed in a country that maybe in South America, or at least in a country where it's warm in the winter. We're talking about Costa Rica, Mexico, but also maybe Portugal in Europe. And it's important that we have less risk about a next lockdown. So what we have seen with countries in Asia, for example, Thailand or Bali, that these countries shut down their border for 2 years. And that is very dangerous for running such a business, because nowadays we don't know how Thailand, for example, will react when a new corona variant is coming and whether they will shut down their borders again. And that's why I'm not ready to take over this risk. It's too risky to buy right now a hostel in Thailand for me, because there is a high chance that I cannot open the hostel or that it will be shut down by the government. So that's why I'm searching a property that had the ability to remain open for the last 2 years, at least for 50%. That's also why, for example, properties in Mexico are getting much more expensive, because these countries are kind of safe to travel because they are not closing the borders.
Mm-hmm. Interesting perspective. You also mentioned like the bar and the community space. And when I was mentioning like looking at the architecture of hostels, that was always a key thing for me, because mm-hmm. I operate hostels from the premise that even though people come to hostels because they want to be social, mm-hmm. most humans are inherently shy. I think all of us have been that person who just arrives at a party, doesn't really know anyone, and it's hard to make conversation.
Yeah.
One of the critical things that mistakes that I've seen many hostels make is that they put the common room down the stairs and into the hall off to the right. Mm-hmm. It needs to be a space. The common room really needs to be a space where people cannot avoid it. They have, anytime they come to the hostel, they're coming right in to the central hub of community. And there they'll always usually encounter, because hostels, there's no strangers, only friends you haven't met. Someone will wave to them and say, "Hey, how are you? Where are you from? Mm-hmm. What's your name?" And then the friendship starts. And bars are obviously easy to do that. I'm not coming here to meet anyone. I'm just coming here to have a beer. Oh, but since we're in conversation, I'll stick around. So,
true. And I'm always looking for hostels that is offering free breakfast. Because mm-hmm. free breakfast is in like maybe from 8 to 10. And every guest wants to take advantage of the free breakfast. So they are coming together on a specific time. And there's also the best chance to meet someone new, because nobody wants to miss this free breakfast. So they set up their alarm clock to get to the free breakfast. And that brings people together as well. Then
Yep.
they're
Okay.
starting
Enjoy.
the day together.
Yep, exactly. Are you looking for a place that's already a hostel, or if you considered a hotel that could be converted to a hostel?
I'm also considering hotels that can be converted to a hostel. The reason why I'm already searching like an existing property that is a hospitality property is that it mostly has all the permission. And it's too risky to build something for me, who has no experience in this area. It's too risky to build something new from scratch. And because there are too many factors that I cannot control. And so that's why I've decided to buy an existing property. And I also want to buy the property and the land, because in this case, I am more secure to invest money. Because from my background and from my companies, I have enough start capital that I can use to invest. And for me, it's too risky to invest a lot of money in renovation in a property that is not my property. Because I saw it also in other interviews that you have uploaded to YouTube, that there are cases where like people want to rent their property to you, and you're starting renovation, everything to renovate everything, and then they cancel the contract.
Yeah. So that's one of the things I say is that when you're renting property, and some hostel owners, that's where they have to start. They don't have the capital in order to buy the property.
Sure.
But you're interviewing the landlord as much as the landlord is interviewing you. So I always say look for landlords that in your gut, and you'll never know for sure, that you think there's no way they want to run a hostel. Because I've seen it happen so many times where they say, hey, this is a successful business. I could do that. And they just kick out the tenant and then they just keep running the hostel, either sometimes even under the same name. So it's good that you're protecting yourself. One of the things I was concerned about is if you're going to another country, if you were going to South America, Central America, it's sometimes difficult to own property. Now, I understand that there's ways around it. Like you can have the property held in trust, or you can have a partner that's from that country. So are you open to those types of things as well?
Depends on how risky it is. For example, in Thailand or Bali, I know it's you have to have someone who's like born and raised there and living there to be the land owner, and there you're always dependent from this person. For Mexico, and now there are ways that you can buy it on your name, but you shouldn't be the official, like a bank should be the official owner. There are always like legal ways that you should take care of. But the goal is that I'm the owner, or that I have 100% control. So maybe I'm not the owner, but I have 100% control.
Not all of the owners who want to sell their property advertise on hostelmanagement.com, because usually that decision, when they're coming to it, it's not like a concrete decision. For a lot of people, they're thinking, I'm getting a little bit old for this business. I still enjoy it, but it's their baby. So they haven't got to the point in their hearts where they've said, okay, I'm going to put out an ad to say that my hostel's for sale. So this is why it's good for you and others who are thinking of starting their own hostels or acquiring a hostel, is you really have to do the door knocking. Contact all of the hostels in all of the places and have a pitch prepared why you could operate their hostel and make it a win for them as well. It sounds like what that's exactly what you're doing.
Exactly. What I've done is I've searched two freelancers who are experienced in the real estate business. I wrote a job offer on Upwork.com, and a former VP applied, and she is supporting me in contacting the possible hostel. We have made a shortlist of 5,000 properties, and now they are contacting each of this property. And it's interesting because it's always hard to get to the contact to the owner, because when you're writing an email or writing a WhatsApp or writing an Instagram direct message, you're mostly addressing like a volunteer who's it's a reception at the moment, so that they're trying to get the contact details of the owner, and then you have to figuring out like who just want to get a price estimation and who is really interested to sell, and then making calls with them to speak with them in person to
yep.
see who is like really interested. And so that's how I get a short list of possible properties that I can buy. So that's the goal.
It's been really great talking to you, Daniel. And I'm going to, when we post this video, I'll obviously include a link to your website. So if you're any hostel owners out there or hotel guest house owners out there that have a property that meets Daniel's requirement, feel free to reach out to him.
Thank you for your support. And I am happy to invest my time and my money to build up a new space where people get together, where people have a really good time. And I want to give the community something back by building up the space. So there is no goal from me to make profit out of this. I want just to build something that is giving people in my age a new possibility to meet.
It's been great talking to you, Daniel. Thank you so much. Best of luck to you. And I look forward to hearing from you again when you actually acquire your property.
Thank you so much for your time
All right,
and your
thanks.
Support.